Welcome to today's final session of the conference. I'm Ernst Schraube from Roskilde University, sitting in my study at home in Copenhagen. I want to introduce you to the keynote speaker, Langdon Winner. Langdon Winner is professor of science and technology studies at RPI in Troy, New York. Langdon represents a critical tradition of thought within STS, focusing on the profound crisis underlying the conditions of modern life and thought and its connections to science and technology. The title of his talk is Preparing for the Wrong Emergency, Visions of Generation-Changing Events. Langdon, are you ready? We are looking forward to your talk.
Greetings. This is Langdon Winner coming to you from Macoit Bay on the coast of Maine. You can see the bay in the fog in the background. I want to thank Ernst Schraube and the other conference organizers for inviting me to speak to you, and I will be tuning into the other events as they proceed during the next few days. I prepared a short talk, which is entitled Generation Changing Events, Preparing for the Wrong Emergency. Frankly, I have no idea how long it will last. We will see. So I'll be looking at notes on the screen at the same time that the video camera, I hope, will be taking sound and photo. This is a part of a move from the Green New Deal to what some people these days are calling the Screen New Deal. Okay, well, it seems to me that under the conditions of the COVID-19 emergency, we are now in a large-scale version of what over the years I have called an epistemological Luddism experiment. The term Luddism here, of course, derives from the name of the British machine-smashing radicals, the ill-fated Luddites, a workers' movement of the early 19th century. But we won't be doing any machine wrecking today, at least not on purpose. Epistemological Luddism is a name for experiences of disconnection or disruption that reveal the extent of our shared dependency upon technological devices and systems. Over the years, I've asked students in my classes to do a short-term version of the epistemological Luddism experiment. I ask them to think about various technological devices and systems that they depend upon very strongly in their everyday lives, and to select just one and thoughtfully disconnect from it for just 1 week. And the assignment is to see what happens and to write about that. So it might be mechanical transportation, artificial lighting, electricity overall, industrial processed foods. A lot of the students have focused on that. Electronic communication of any kind. So the use of anything predicated on the burning of fossil fuels. Of course, I ask that the students avoid doing anything obviously dangerous or health-threatening. In other words, please don't go off your meds. Instead, just connect temporarily from a piece of apparatus crucial in your everyday life. What changes do you notice? Over the years, the results of the epistemological Luddism experiment in my classes have been consistent. Most students are just not able to complete it after the first 2 or 3 days. They soon feel a strong need to reconnect with the particular system of technology they've abandoned. Otherwise, what happens is that the patterns of their everyday life, in their studies, in their living units, and so forth, begin to fall apart. So what they learn on an individual level is an awareness of extreme dependency in their relationships to technological devices and systems, indeed to the whole technological realm in general. My hope is that they begin to see such matters as open to renegotiation, perhaps creative reinvention. A lot of them are engineers who take things really at face value. So to open up new possibilities can be a creative act. In larger settings, of course, there have been historical episodes of serious technological disruption that have affected large populations. So a question would be here, what kinds of collective experiences and memories did that involve? For example, in 1965, there was an extended regional power outage that shut off electricity to New York City. Reports at the time, in 1965, generally noticed how people came together in friendly mutual support and helpfulness. So people responded in very positive ways. In stark contrast was another New York blackout, one in 1977. That one lasted 2 full days. And in that case, there were reports of widespread looting, arson, and other kinds of criminal behavior. I once met a person who was trapped in an apartment during one such incident. He lived in an upper story unit. And he could hear the smashing and crashing and other noise taking place down below. Eventually, the police arrived, so he avoided any injury or damage. Well, it's in this mood that I read news about the COVID-19 pandemic and wide-ranging disconnections and emergencies it has brought to technology-centered societies worldwide. What do these powerful interruptions in everyday patterns reveal to us? Are there strategies of inquiry that might illuminate such experiences of disconnection from essential life supports, as well as experiences of socio-technical disorder? Now, while I don't watch much television, I often tune in these days to news about the pandemic and its implications. So at present, there's an extremely eerie contrast projected on American TV screens. The central news reports focus upon steadily rising statistics on millions of people infected, tens of thousands of deaths around the globe, as well as dirty statistics about job loss. Presently in the USA, there are about 35 million people unemployed, as well as tens of thousands who now face bankruptcy. And as I follow these grim reports on American commercial television, I can't help but notice the bizarre spectacles that accompany the news segments, namely the video advertisements showing wonderfully happy consumers, usually in small groups of friends and family, enjoying their speedy new automobiles, their delicious comfort foods, those wonderful Caribbean vacations, as well as the marvelous pharmaceutical products that promise healthy, joyous ways of living. So there's a jarring contrast between news reports about illness, death, crowded hospitals, the imposition of quarantines, social distancing, and the like, posed side by side with depictions from video advertisements to show the happy world of consumerism and its colorful celebrations, conditions that were prevalent until just about a month earlier. Of course, these frivolous TV commercials were produced many weeks before the pandemic hit. Only recently have some of the advertisements begun to change, now pointing to, let's say, the serious challenge that we face and the need for people to join together in quest of the common good. But the basic contrast is still there. Disasters of the pandemic portrayed side by side with visions of a much happier, even frivolous world from several weeks ago. More recently, of course, there are frequent stories about portions of the populace in open revolt against the requirements of lockdown and social distancing. Some of these people are even carrying guns, making sure that an illegally open pizza parlor remains open. So this is America after all, and this is the way that this kind of social stress for a certain part of the populace is focused and organized. Actually, the recent stories that the billionaires who have funded these armed protests to keep the economy open have stopped funding those protests because they realize that if there were any acts of violence, they, the billionaire funders, might be held liable. Okay, so the question is, how soon will these, and how will these tensions and conflict be resolved? That question has special relevance in my teaching. As the recent disasters unfolded and my university completely shut down as a place of personal social interaction, the students took off to their family homes in distant locations in North America and around the world, and they now communicate with me and each other in virtual digital space. Maybe you're having the same experiences where you work as well. So in one class, I asked the group to form teams and then to explore and think about how these COVID-19 conditions might alter their futures in a larger sense. And in particular, I pointed to the kinds of calamities and emergencies that over time have proved to be generation-changing events. What would happen if a whole generation of young people, when suddenly, literally everything changes? This is not an abstract question for them. A college student expectations about where they will be living, what they'll be doing during the next two or 3 years or so have been thoroughly repealed. So their visions of a college education, of career paths, of summer jobs, international travels and the like have been abruptly suspended. And for most of them, there are no clear alternative paths yet in view. Now, in historical writings, there are actually descriptions of earlier periods in which whole generations are confronted with calamities that drastically alter the conventional patterns of everyday life. On the list of such disruptive emergencies, one finds the effects of war, epidemic, famine, economic collapse, political revolution, and natural catastrophe. So how do individuals, small groups, and indeed whole nations experience and adapt to these disruptions over extended periods of time? How do these periods of disorder become the source of long-term memories and perhaps important lessons? Which ones typically fade away within collective consciousness? Well, of course, there's no uniform answer, and I'm beginning just to sort through various patterns. Crucial impressions vary, of course, according to a person's group, or a whole nation's character and its situation within historical time. For example, in my parents' generation, there were two world-changing disruptors. One was the Great Depression of the 1930s, and the other was, of course, World War II. For a variety of reasons, for them, it was only the Depression that left lasting memories. They often talked about how they left failing farms and bankrupt shops in Montana and moved west to the promised land of California. But their experience of World War II, my parents' experience, was never a focus of stories or significant lessons. My father was a college teacher, and he had been hired to administer a program for naval officers in the early 1940s, and therefore he himself did not go off to fight any battles in Europe or the Pacific. So a direct experience of war did not become part of the family narrative or memory. So looking at disruptive emergencies in historical time, let's say the early 20th century, it's relevant that two parallel calamities, World War I and then the pandemic of 1918-1919, left distinctly different impressions upon historical memory. What in Britain and the U.S. came to be called the War to End All Wars was, of course, vividly remembered and honored, and even celebrated after decades after its conclusion. And it seems that rallying the populace to sort of military campaign often holds a powerful fascination in the collective national experience, perhaps over a long period of time. So the widely shared challenge of threat, battle, hardship, and even victory obviously affected memories and visions that were later called into play at the onset of World War II. In contrast, even though the influenza pandemic 1918-1919 actually claimed a far greater number of total casualties than the violence of World War I, the disaster seems to have left little decisive impression on the long-term national memory, at least in the USA. So yes, the pandemic was depicted in a number of very fine literary writings, poems, and novels written during the decades that followed. But the pandemic itself and its human toll is almost never mentioned in books of general American history or featured in the nation's public rhetoric. It's almost as if the hundreds of thousands of lives lost did not matter much in framing the experience of later generations. Indeed, that contrast between the experience of war and the experience of pandemic may be echoed in our current situation, the era of COVID-19. So it may be the case that mentalities and memories of pandemic tend to be highly personal, largely isolated sources of tragedy among families, friends, and local communities, rather than centers of intense feelings of national solidarity and common purpose of the sort that wars often inspire. So families and friends remember the suffering and death of those affected by the disease, and of course cherish those who passed, but there's typically no need for a strongly magnified vocal or symbolic remembrance of the vast collectivities who perished in waves of disease and illness. Perhaps those listening to this talk have different ideas about this, and I'd be interested to hear your reflections. My hypothesis, let's say the difference between the experience of war and the experience of pandemic, may be wrong. Indeed, there's strong evidence that the combined experience of World War I and World War II set the stage for deeply seated generational mindsets of collective purpose and experience and collective organization that have endured in the USA for 75 years or more. Thus, the country continues to spend $1 trillion a year on the Pentagon, if you count all the costs involved, and faced what was promoted as the urgent post 9/11 global war on terror, America has forked up $6.4 trillion on conflicts in Iraq, Afghanistan, and other regional battles during the past two decades. I might say in passing that the 9/11 war on terror for the current generation of students, who are about, 18, 19, 21, that no longer has much of an imprint. So if you talk to them about the world-changing effects of 9/11, it means almost nothing to them. As reflected in the recently published Afghanistan papers coming out of the Pentagon, revelations from military brass, much like those of the Pentagon Papers published in the early 1970s, the rationale revealed for the extended feudal conflicts involved is largely based upon illusions and misrepresentations, to state the matter politely. So the recollections of the emergency are to a large extent simply fabricated. Yet the country, the USA, is still locked into a pattern of highly costly arrangements for the next big emergency, the next big battle, for example, as the country endlessly prepares for today, look like the wrong emergencies. Indeed, a derangement of this kind has already surfaced in imaginaries prompted by the COVID-19 crisis. A distinctive feature of the American response has been perverse, even aggressive kinds of patriotism, especially as evident in the rhetoric and gestures of Donald Trump. At a moment in which there is an urgent need for an organized international approach to finding ways to address what is clearly a global crisis, Trump behaves in an excessively narrow, nationalistic way, describing international inquiries and remedies for public health, let's say research programs, including development of effective vaccines, as steps contrary to patriotic U.S. initiatives. And in that same light, he describes those suffering and dying from COVID-19 as warriors, fighting an invisible inquiry, as he calls it, language that reflects the common view that warfare is the only cause that reliably brings Americans together in a mood of strong solidarity. Recently, Trump carried this bizarre military imagery completely over the top, saying, "They are warriors, aren't they? When you see them going into those hospitals, I see that doctors and nurses and so many of the people going into these hospitals. It's incredible to see. It's a beautiful thing to see." Okay, at present, much of the speculation about how to understand the broader dimensions of the COVID-19 emergency centers upon its social, institutional, cultural, and personal ramifications, although the term most commonly used to describe these possibilities in the USA is just the economy. Thus, we hear about the urgent need to reopen the American economy after several weeks in which cautionary measures limited the activities of businesses and the freedoms of consumers. That seems to me a highly inadequate way of focusing our attention, because it focuses mainly upon matters of money-making employment, wages, the stock market, and so forth. And while such matters are certainly important, they overlook the ways that social practices, social relationships, and institutional bonds are crucial to a much broader and deeper fabric of everyday life, its meanings and satisfactions. So the conditions of shutdown, of social distancing, quarantine, virus testing and tracking, and the like, now cut into and affect the social fabric in countless crucial ways. Ways not adequately expressed or measured in dollars spent or earned or in jobs lost or created, businesses closed down or reopened. In other words, the human dimensions, I think, shrivel in perspective as the focus comes to rest upon money. So the places where people work, where people gather for a variety of everyday activities, dining, schooling, shopping, exercise, entertainment, worship, recreation, and countless others, have been powerfully disrupted and often deeply injured by the need to avoid contamination by the virus. And you see lots of efforts everywhere to try to reweave the fabric of culture of social contact in the face of these conditions. But the idea of Trump and others that there's a need to move on to reopen the economy is, in my view, a completely inadequate understanding of what's at stake here. In my own primary occupation, and perhaps your own as well, that of education, the issues and challenges we now face include what to do under conditions in which simply gathering people together in locations where they can work together to inquire, discuss, teach, learn, and experience each other's presence may be impossible or at least heavily constrained. While the so-called economic dimensions of this predicament are highly significant, in other words, where will the money come and how will it be spent, the more fundamental challenges, I believe, have to do with the social arrangements of any lively educational experience. So in that light, proposals to repair or replace conventional social relationships in schools, colleges, and universities need careful scrutiny. The idea that one can simply plug in platforms of distant teaching and learning and live happily ever after, I think, is at best highly problematic. Indeed, a common model in distance education assumes that the crucial goal is the transfer of knowledge from point A, that is the proximate source of information, perhaps in the head of the professor, to point B, the mind of the student. And it's common in some quarters to think when that transfer to point A to point B takes place, well, behold, education has been realized. Now, there are circumstances where in which the that model works pretty well. Indeed, the old-fashioned model of a lecturer standing at the front of the room and students listening quietly in rows of chairs in a large hall, that's the conventional realization of the same format. But anybody with a well-grounded sense of a rich educational experience quickly recognizes the grave limitations of this way of doing things. Unless, of course, they work for an online educational provider where that simple model is enough. Without going into great length about the fundamental problems in this and similar models of existing or potential digital virtual replacements for in-person educational experiences, I believe the limitations of such replacements should be clear to us all. At all levels, the magic and marvels of education, both for teachers and students and all others involved, have to do with interpersonal relationships, communications, both formal and informal. So the realities of any decent school, college, or university camp will involve the presence and interactions of living humans who, one can hope, enjoy and learn from each other's understandings, cares, talents, and colorful idiosyncrasies. I mention school and college settings because I know them best. And as for millions of other people, I am currently involved with conditions and choices that the COVID emergency presents. For example, the need to curtail the size and social distance of social groups affects current routines of standardized testing for college admission. Moving to fully online tests raises issues of honesty and cheating. If there are no eyes on those taking the test to verify who's who, how can one determine exactly who produced the answers? And long before the current pandemic arrived, there were tremendous scandals in American college admissions that involved wealthy families paying stand-in test takers to help get their children gain admission to prestigious colleges. But this may be a problem for which there are clever technical solutions. When you remove conventional social practice and practices and state safeguards, there's a lot of work to be done in designing suitable replacements. So in education and other institutional settings, what's these days called reopening the economy actually involves reopening society and renegotiating the basic cultural settings and practices. And one has to ask at that point, well, what is it that we hope to accomplish? Will we simply try to revive old patterns and get them working in full operation again? A common way of thinking about this, certainly in the USA, maybe in Europe as well, is to say, well, let's restore the normal, the way things worked before the pandemic struck. And for while many people, this seems a perfectly fine goal, it's also clear that many of the conditions that have long been normal in society are just not worth bringing back. So why go into all of the work when the patterns that you are restoring are not all that admirable? Over the past several decades in my own country, the normal has included patterns of everyday life characterized by vast and growing inequalities of wealth and income. Also, pervasive, deeply rooted patterns of racism and social injustice throughout the nation. A rapidly growing erosion of democratic governance and its replacement by increasingly aggressive forms of oligarchic power. And the return of varieties of pollution and environmental devastation, matched by official neglect of efforts to respond to the growing evidence of climate crisis. Along with that, we have the growing influence of openly dysfunctional public and private institutions, for example, those of healthcare, whose grave enduring troubles now occupy the very center of American way of life. So we have lots of practices and institutions which are widely recognized as dysfunctional and corrupt. And if these prominent patterns will simply be restored as components of the normal, frankly, you know, who needs it? Indeed, one glaring set of patterns revealed by the pandemic is the extent to which poor and racial minorities have been disproportionately affected by levels of illness, job loss, and death, along with a wide variety of social and cultural maladies. African Americans make up about 13% of the U.S. population, but they experience 27% of known COVID-19 deaths. According to data gathered by researchers at several leading universities, counties in the country with higher populations of black residents, account for 52% of coronavirus diagnoses and 58% of COVID-19 deaths nationally. 58% of COVID-19 deaths nationally. Of course, the reasons for such disparity have to do with the conditions of everyday living, of work and dwelling for black citizens. For example, it is not uncommon for African American adults to have jobs that necessarily must be done in person and in a particular place. Driving a bus, cooking in a cafeteria, for example, jobs that are not easily configured for social distancing or conveniently redefined as telework in one's home. Online work is still largely a privilege for the middle and upper middle classes. So if you're going to move a lot of such activity online, then you have to look at issues about social class and race. From another point of view, it would seem that the COVID-19 virus has held up a mirror to society as a whole and often revealed some highly troubling features. As journalists, politicians, and everyday citizens look at the evidence of economic recession and widespread job loss happening at the present time, a common remedy has been to rush toward a reconstruction of familiar patterns in social and economic life as quickly as possible. So let's open the old factories, the schools, the shops, the malls, the restaurants, theaters, and the like, and return to ways of life that were prevalent, say, 6 months ago. Many people seem willing to do this, even though it would likely cause even larger waves of illness and death within the country. So at the present moment, this is what we're talking about in America. Should we reopen things and then face perhaps more catastrophic waves of pandemic in the fall? Or, you know, what should we do? In that light, the historical experience of longstanding emergencies might rise to positions of supreme importance in our reflections. During the past 50 years, there has been a slowly dawning awareness about what is truly an existential crisis for humanity as a whole and for life on Earth as a whole, something of even greater magnitude than the COVID-19 pandemic. And of course, I refer to climate change, sometimes dismissed as climate change when actually it's a climate crash, and its implications for Earth's biosphere as a suitable place for habitation by human beings and countless other species. In sheer magnitude, the world-altering significance of this pattern is the most, obviously, would be the most momentous generation-changing event of all now on the horizon. So far, however, worldwide recognition of this grave crisis has been rather slow to emerge. One reason may be that evidence of the emergence has taken place rather gradually over the years. Significant events, heat waves, floods, monster storms, rising seas, rising levels of extinction of species and the like often fade into people's awareness and then leave as time passes. It also seems, by the way, that the rigor and disciplinary subtleties of scientific studies about relevant dimensions of this crisis may pose a barrier to public understanding. So climate scientists in multiple disciplines must, of course, rely upon the critical evaluation and support of their audiences of scientific peers. Yet over time, they've been very slow to adopt modes of communication that convey the tremendous urgency that emerges from their research. Too often their attitude seems to be, well, the numbers speak for themselves, so let's take action. And when we publish the data and supporting theory, that will be sufficient to impel the world community to take action. But so far, the broader mobilization has been a very slow and inadequate. And the question that arises, I think, an interesting one, is it possible that the COVID-19 pandemic could be the catalyst that propels that crisis emerging in Earth's biosphere as a whole into much sharper focus and with a stronger sense of emergency? And indeed, some key features in the worldwide response to coronavirus suggest some potentially fruitful connections. So a quick glance at today's situation reveals that as regards automobile, truck, and airline traffic, there have recently been substantial reductions in the number of trips taken and the distances traveled. For the week of May 11th, the number of flights worldwide, according to news reports, was down 68.4% as compared to a year earlier. Similarly, data on U.S. automobile mileage shows a 50 to 70% reduction since the beginning of the pandemic. At present, automobile sales in the United States are down by 800,000 cars as compared to the expected market levels. The newspaper photographs show vast fields of abandoned sedans waiting in lonely isolation. Even more interesting is the fact that the overall worldwide distribution of carbon emissions are predicted to decline by 8% for the year 2000. So carbon emissions worldwide, a reduction of 8% for the year. Now, this is roughly the level of reduction specified by world nations, according to the Paris Accords, within the key goal of holding long-term increase in warming to 1.5 degrees centigrade. So we have now achieved our 8% reduction for 2020. At least we're well on the way. Of course, the bad news is that this highly promising accomplishment has been achieved only through the collapse of industrial civilization. So you say, well, nobody's perfect. But is it too much to hope the world populations and governments might come to regard the response to COVID-19 as an illuminating trial run that points to the urgent need for sweeping reforms that could address not only climate crash, but numerous long-term structural problems in world societies as well, especially current levels of inequality, social injustice, and grotesque concentrations of wealth in the hands of the greedy few. Now, a favorable sign is that a great many people in world societies have shown that they are ready to change their basic patterns of living, and actually to do that rather rapidly, at least for the time being. And they're doing this in the attempt to bring the pandemic under control. So there's actually been remarkable changes in people's living patterns in recent weeks. It's also worth noting that some world societies, including my own, are prepared to spend huge amounts of public monies, even trillions of dollars, in attempts to repair and restore the social and economic institutions affected by the disease. This, by the way, stands in stark contrast to move by the Trump administration to portray climate crisis as a kind of left-wing hoax and to eliminate funding for climate change initiatives, There are some people who notice the connection and say, well, at the same time, we're attending to the pandemic. We could also look at the conditions of climate change. So in thoughtful publications that track the relationship between high quality science and shrewd business thinking, one finds thoughtful contrasts between strategies that pursue conventional pump up the economy approaches as compared to approaches of economic recovery after the COVID-19 crisis, and including in that framework strategies based upon greening and cutting carbon emissions. Thus, the publication Climate Action Tracker shows a government roadmap for addressing the climate and post-COVID-19 economic crisis. And on its list include incentives for zero emission vehicles, that is a government target, direct investments in low carbon public transport, support for accelerated construction of low and zero energy buildings, large-scale landscape restoration and reforestation efforts. And there's a long list of other measures having to do with pandemic and global climate crash as the target for productive activity. Thus, within the overall goal of economic recovery, one finds very elaborate proposals for policies and investments that combine the pandemic with key goals and policies of the Paris Agreement. Okay, on that note, I'll bring my remarks to a close, leaving you with the following question. Is it possible that the curse of COVID-19 might turn out to be a blessing in disguise? Thank you very much.